So welcome to lecture 4. In the last lecture, we were looking at what non-idealities there exist in a two-way sample and hold and what the effect of those non-linearities is on the performance of the sample and hold. Last time we also saw we saw that using a time interleaved sample and hold has its problems. The advantage of being able to sample at one half the rate of the overall system comes with some disadvantages. For instance, we saw that if there is offset in each of these channels, when you stitch the sequence together, finally there is an artifact in the form of a tone at fs by 2 in addition to a DC offset that you normally expect, right. Further, because of the way the sample and hold is designed, it is not possible to have exactly the same gain in both the paths. And as we were seeing last time around, if there is a gain error or a gain mismatch between the two paths, that introduces artifacts in the spectrum and that appears as a multiplicative effect, where you take the original sequence and multiply it by a sequence which can be written as a constant plus one which has a component at fs by 2, right, or at omega equal to pi, right. And we went through the math the last time, and let me just quickly summarize what we dealt with the last time around. So if there is offset between the two channels, what happens? What are the effects? There will be a tone at fs by 2 or omega equal to pi and a DC offset. If there is a gain error or a gain mismatch, what would we expect the last time around? We said that if there is a gain mismatch between the two channels, right, it is like taking the original sequence, the ideal sequence that you were supposed to get out, perhaps was something like this, and it is like multiplying it with a sequence which is 1 plus alpha, 1 plus beta, 1 plus alpha, 1 plus beta, and so on. Does it make sense? Okay. And this sequence, as we, so this is 1 plus alpha, and this is 1 plus beta, and this sequence, as we saw the last time, can be represented as DC plus a tone at all right. So it is like taking the ideal sequence and modulating it with a tone at omega equal to pi or fs by 2. So if you modulate or multiply a signal with a sine wave, you will see sidebands. So if the input was a tone at f in, you will see in the output spectrum tones corresponding to fs by 2 plus minus f in. In the discrete time domain, you will see tones at pi plus minus f in by f s times 2 pi, correct. So if you were trying to infer what the input signal was by looking at the sequence at the output of the sample and hold, and if you are not aware that there is a gain error, then you would make the mistake of assuming that the input tone consists of not only f n but also fs by 2 minus fn. You understand? All that I wanted to appreciate is that this is an error, okay, and that is happening because of the time interleaved nature of the system. Now, if one went further and said I am going to do a 3-way interleaving, you can go through the math, it just becomes messier, and there you will see that each channel is now sampling at fs by 3 and there are 3 channels, okay. So, when you when there will be significant aliasing in all the 3 channels, but if things are just right, when you add all the outputs together, 2 of those images get cancelled off, okay, and you are left with, you know, the ideal expression that you would expect for a simple for a single channel sample and hold operating at fs. Does it make sense? And please note that this, I mean, the output becoming magically equivalent to a single channel sample and hold operating at fs is being achieved by cancellation of the aliased images in all the 3 channels, and any technique which is based on cancellation will always be sensitive to, well, everything is sensitive to non-idealities, right, but anywhere you are expecting to get 0 by subtracting 2 quantities, you are banking on the fact that the 2 quantities are exactly matched, right. So, if one of them is slightly larger than the other, the cancellation is not perfect, which will lead to artifacts which we have seen mathematically for the 2 channel case. The last ideality or last deviation from ideality I want to consider is what is called timing skew. So, ideally the samples we expect to get on the top channel are x of 0, x of 2t, x of 4t and so on, and the samples one expects at the in the lower channel are x of t, x of 3t, x of 5t and so on, right. So, what do we mean when we say there is a timing skew between the 2 channels? Obviously, there is already a timing skew in the sense that one channel is sampling at a time instant which is t skewed from the sampling instance of the other channel. So, when we mean timing skew, it means that, what does it mean? The other channel is not sampling exactly at a time t apart, it is sampling at a time, say t plus tau. So, this is ideal, this is time skewed, and that is x of say t plus tau, x of 3 t plus tau, x of 5 t plus tau and so on. You understand? So, when you stitch the sequences together, the actual sequence you get will be x of 0, x of t plus tau, x of t, x of 2 t, x of 3 t plus tau, x of 4 t and so on. Clearly, this is not the same as the ideals, I mean not the same as the spectrum that not the same as the sequence that you would expect it to get if the timing skew was 0. So, can you tell me a way in which you can determine the spectrum or relate the spectrum of this discrete time sequence to the spectrum of the continuous time signal assuming tau is small. So, this is the actual sequence, this is the ideal sequence. What is the ideal sequence? X of 0, x of t, x of 2 t, x of 3 t, x of 4 t, and so on. All right. So, what is the error? So, the error is basically nothing but the top sequence minus the, I mean the actual sequence minus the ideal sequence. So, this becomes 0, and for small tau what can you approximate the error as? I mean by Taylor series x of t plus tau is approximately x of t plus tau dx by dt evaluated at t equal to capital T, correct. So, the error sequence is simply tau dx of t by dt, okay, evaluated at t equal to capital T, which I will abbreviate using the following notation, it is x prime of t, correct. The next error sequence sample is 0, the next sequence is tau times x prime of 3 t, 0, and so on. Does it make sense? Okay. So, one thing to notice is that if the input signal is varying slowly, what do you think the error sequence is? Do you think it will be small or large? It will be small. Why does that make sense? So, the input is varying slowly. By definition, it means that if you sample it a little off the ideal point, it is not changed by very much, correct, which means that the error sequence will be small. In other words, you are going to really get hit by timing skew when the input frequency is high, and that makes sense also from this expression here. You see that the error sequence has got terms which are a proportional to tau, the timing skew, that makes sense because if you deviate wildly from the ideal timing instance, you can expect to make a lot bigger error. Further, you also see that it is dependent on the derivative of the input signal, which means that the input which is varying fast is likely to be sampled with a bigger error in the presence of timing skew, right. Both these are intuitively apparent. I leave the job of finding the actual spectrum as an exercise for you in your homeworks. You can proceed along the same lines as we did earlier, right. One way of attacking the problem is to either try and find the spectrum of this sequence, right. This is nothing but, I mean, what is the spectrum of this sequence? Yes, great. So, the you know the spectrum, so this is like the error sequence is like taking x of t, passing it through a differentiator, correct, so that you get d by dt, okay. Sampling this at a sampling rate of 1 by, I mean sampling it every 2 t seconds, okay, and then skewing it appropriately and finding the spectrum. Okay. You know this spectrum, you know this spectrum, this will be the Fourier transform of the signal there is simply j 2 pi f times x of f. Then you know what happens when you take a continuous time signal and sample it at a given rate, right, and so on. So you can directly find the input spectrum, I mean the spectrum at the output. So this is the expression for the error between the ideal spectrum you expect in the discrete time domain and the actual one you get because of timing skew. Is this clear? Okay. So the last point I as far as the Fourier transform part is concerned that I wish to bring to your attention is the following. If you think about it, what we have done is taken conceptually, taken the signal, the input signal, passed it through two filters. One filter has got a gain of 1, the other one has got a transfer function of e to the plus j 2 pi f t, correct. We have sampled both these at the rate f s by 2 or 1 by 2 t hertz, correct. And then what have we done? We have inserted, now we have two discrete time sequences each with a rate of f s by 2 samples per second. Each of these channels results in aliasing. Now what we have done is upsampled both these sequences. And pass them through, in principle, a digital filter on each channel. On the channel on top, the digital filter also has a transfer function of 1. And in the lower channel, what did we do? So we had was a delay, but you can think of a delay as a digital filter with a transfer function z inverse, and then we added the two outputs. So this is an analog filter bank, right. This is a digital filter bank, and as far as this entire box is concerned, it looks like a sample and hold operating at fs, okay. All right. So it turns out that this is the special case of a general principle called multi-channel sampling, okay. So you can extend this to n channels. Where the general idea is like this. If you have n samples, if you have n channels, you can sample at infinity. So you sample each of these channels at fs by n, right. So at the output of each of these channels, there will be a lot of aliasing, okay. However, if you upsample each one of these up by a factor of n and then pass them through digital filters, so if you pack all of this inside a box and you chose these analog filter bank transfer functions properly and the digital filter bank transfer functions also properly, okay, it is possible to stitch all these outputs together to make the whole system look like a single system operating at fs. In other words, you have taken each channel and made the apparent sampling rate higher by a factor of n by having an n channel system. So this is what is called multi-channel sampling. All right, and depending on the choice of the analog and the digital filters, you will have different degrees of aliasing along each channel, but when you stitch them all together, the aliases will all cancel, just like what we saw in the two channel case, where these analog filters are called the analysis filters and the digital filters are called the synthesis filters, okay. So in our special case of two channel sampling, the analysis filters are very simple. One is simply a time delay, the other one is simply 1, and the digital filters are also correspondingly very simple, one is 1 and the other one is simply a delay element, Z inverse. Does it make sense? Okay. All right. So please note that this is very dependent on the nature of the transfer functions of the filters. For instance, you can't say I'm going to use the same. I'm going to cheat by using the same H1 in all the analysis filters. Do you think then the system will work? Pardon? What is the meaning of you won't get the right sample? Yeah, I know, but why? I mean, if you cheat and say I am going to have the same filters in all the arms, clearly I am not getting, I am getting the same sequences at the output of every channel, so obviously that is not helping. I mean, you understand, this is a concept that we are all very familiar with in daily life. You know, in India there is this is an institution called arranged marriage, you understand. Right, so you know there's you find some bridegroom and some bride, and you know inquiries begin. You understand? So the bride's party will ask you know whom all they can find, right? Who is even remotely associated with the bridegroom? You understand? The idea is to be able to sample the bridegroom's, you know, x, y, z, t as a function of time with as high a resolution as possible. Obviously, you can't keep tagging along with the bridegroom like 24/7, right. So, what do? You will ask his neighbor, right. You will ask his boss, right. You will ask his teacher, you will ask his friends, okay. So, each one of these guys is a filter which is being exposed to the true signal you want to sample, correct. You understand? And you look at the outputs of each of these filters and attempt to reconstruct what the true x of t is, you know, okay. So, if one of his friends tells you, oh, he gets drunk every night in a bar, you know, right, regardless of what everybody else tells you, okay, that basically means that there is a problem, you know, right, or there is no problem at all, you know, as the case may be, you understand. So, I mean, multi-channel sampling is something we are all, you know, commonsensically we are all used to this, okay. Of course, it does not make sense to ask his father, you ask his mother, you ask his brother, you ask his sister, it does not make any sense at all. Why? They are most likely to say the same thing. So, you need to get as many independent opinions as possible, and then after that, you know, you need the synthesis filter is here where you take all these inputs and try and reconstruct the original signal which you have never seen, you are only seeing these outputs, correct, and many times you only have one sample, right, okay. From that you are trying to reconstruct what x is. In the same way, there must be some degree of independence with respect to these analysis filter transfer functions. They cannot be all the same or related to each other. You understand, okay. So, I mean, you might be wondering where this kind of approach is used at all. It turns out that in some very high speed scopes or in very high speed waveform digitizers, right, it is just simply impossible to get the kind of sampling speed that you would want to achieve. So, one approach is of course to try and do time interleaved sampling like the way we discussed, but one disadvantage of time interleaved sampling is that even though you are sampling at a rate which is much lower than the overall sampling rate, the signal at the input of each switch is varying just as fast for all the sample and holds. Is that, am I clear? For example, look at this, even though there are two channels and the output of each channel is being sampled at fs by 2, we see that the signal here at the output of the first channel varies just as fast or rapidly as the signal here. The same thing will happen if you have many n sample and holds queued by n clock cycles, okay. So, then the signal is varying very fast, it turns out, as we will see going forward, that sampling can become a challenge. One thing which is challenging to begin with is to sample at such a high rate. We try to avoid that by having many sample and holds operating slowly, right. However, the input bandwidth seen by each sampler is still the same, okay, which can become problematic when there is real transistors and real circuits, which is why sometimes an approach to use is to have a more complicated set of filters, right. One straightforward but a non-trivial example is to say, let's say I have a bank of band pass filters, each one with a bandwidth of 1nth the signal. Let us say the signal varies from, has a bandwidth fs by 2, fs is the overall sampling rate. The signal bandwidth is 0 to fs by 2. Now, if I pass this input signal through a bank of n filters, each of which has a bandwidth of fs by 2n, then what would be the outputs of each of these, what would be the bandwidths at the output of each of these filters? The output of each of these filters would be narrow band signals with a bandwidth of fs by 2n, correct. Now, if the bandwidth is fs by 2n, then it means that the signal is narrow band, which means that from cycle to cycle, give or take a carrier, there is significant correlation between adjacent samples, which makes, presumably makes the sampling easier. You understand? So, however, the moment you have a complicated bunch of analysis and synthesis filters, as we discussed with the time interleaved case, this aliasing which is happening in all channels is getting cancelled out, okay, and resulting in the nice equivalent sampling of at a rate of fs, and every time you cancel, you are dependent on this matching, something matching with something somewhere else, and most often you will find that the cancellation is not perfect, which means that you will see a whole bunch of artifacts in the spectrum. The analysis of those artifacts is likely to be a lot more messy when you have general filters in the analysis bank, okay. All right. So, anyway, this is something to just be borne in mind, that if you have a signal, you can sample it at one end the rate. If you have n channels where the analysis filters are reasonably independent, then it is possible to reconstruct perfectly a signal, even though on each channel there is significant aliasing. Yes.
The frequency of operation is very high frequency, right?
The center frequency is high, but the bandwidth is low.
So, the sampler has issue only with the bandwidth, or?
Well, in principle, you can say that if the signal is narrow band, right, it is much easier to design a sampler than if the signal is broad band. You understand? In principle, you know that, if you have a narrow band signal, what does it mean? It means that between successive samples, there is significant correlation. That is what it means, is not it? If it is a band pass, if it is a band pass signal with narrow bandwidth, you know that it is almost a sine wave at the center frequency, it is just minor variations around that sine wave, correct. So, it is, while it is not easy to do, it is certainly easier to do than trying to sample a system where the bandwidth is very high. Okay. All right. So, this covers all that I had to say about continuous time to discrete time conversion as far as relating the transforms of the two sequences are concerned. The next thing is to actually see what circuits you can, how you can design circuits to implement the basic building block of all these structures, which is the sampling and holding. Okay. So, what is So, conceptually, what is the simplest sample and hold that you can think of? You need a switch, okay, and you need a capacitor, which is some device which holds charge. So, So when the switch is closed, how will the output waveform look like? Let us say the input was like this. How will the output waveform look like? Let us say the switch is closed for 1/2 the clock period, which I denote like this, and is open for the other half of the clock period. So how will you think, what do you think the output waveform looks like? During 1/2 it will, if the switch is ideal, it will follow or track the input. During the other half it will hold. Then what will happen? If the switch is ideal, it will jump up immediately to the input waveform again during the next track phase, hold, track, hold, track, hold, and so on. The black is the input. So sometimes circuits like these are also what are called track and hold, where the tracking operation happens for a part of the clock cycle and the holding operation is there for the rest of the clock cycle. In this particular example, I have chosen the track period to be 1/2, the clock period, and the hold period also to be 1/2. Okay, sounds simple enough. Now let us see what all non-idealities there are in this system. What is the only problematic part in the whole thing? We need a switch which can be controlled by some signal and make it turn either on or off. So without getting into the details of the implementation of the switch, what do you think is the basic non-ideality that you can attribute to a switch? The first thing I can think of is on resistance. That is, we have assumed that the switch behaves like an ideal one. So when you close it, it behaves like a short circuit. Quite intuitively, or rather it is not very surprising that a real switch will have some on resistance. So now let us see what happens when there is on resistance. So if this is Vi, let us say this is A cos omega in t, during the track phase this is the equivalent circuit. What do you think will be out will be? Please note that the input is a sinusoid. What will be the time domain waveform at the output in steady state? There will be a change in amplitude, there will be a change in phase. What will be the amplitude at the output? A divided by square root of 1 plus omega square r on square c square and cos omega n t minus some phi, where phi is tan inverse omega n times r on times c. Does it make sense? Right. In the track phase, this is simply a first order RC filter. So, if you want the output to track the input properly, what is the design consideration? For a given C, how will you choose R?
Very less.
Very less.
Pardon?
Omega RC should be less.
Smaller when compared to
1.
So, if you want the output amplitude to be A closely, or you want it to be a good replica of the input, then the best you can do is to make sure that omega n RC is much, much smaller than 1. In English, this means that the time period of the input sinusoid is much greater or much lesser than the RC time constant. No, don't look at the equation, think and tell me. If you want the output to follow the input properly, do you want the input period to be very large or very small compared to the time constant of the RC circuit? The input time period must be many, many, many time constants of the RC circuit, correct? Which is what this is telling you, right? This is telling you that RC must be much, much smaller than 1 by omega n. 1 by omega n is related to the period, okay. So, in other words, to have a good tracking bandwidth, 1 by RC is nothing but the bandwidth during the tracking phase. To have a good tracking bandwidth, you must make sure that the 1 by R on times C time constant is very, very small, okay. So, the tracking bandwidth determines the RC time constant, or that is how you choose the RC time constant. Is that clear? Okay. The next question is, there are many ways of choosing R and C which result in the same time constant. For example, you know R and C will result in tau, R by 2 C also results in a time constant of tau, right. 10 R and C by 10 also results in the same time constant tau. So, logical question to ask is, there are many choices of RC which give me the same time constant during the track phase, which is equivalent to saying that they will all result in the same bandwidth during the track phase. So, the question is there a reason to prefer one set of RCs over the other? Or does it not matter? We can choose anything. I mean, see, there seems to be an advantage to doing this. Well, how would you argue that this is a, if you did not know anything else, how would you argue about this being a better choice? I need to use a very small capacitance and a large switch resistance, okay. I mean, to get a given time constant, I can use either a small switch resistance and a large capacitance, or a large switch resistance and a
switch resistance and a small capacitance, because this means that I can use a bad switch and get away. Correct? Any comments on that one?
Leakage.
One problem is that if the signal is being held as charge on a capacitor. The smaller you make the capacitor,
leakage is
more. I mean, the more the probability of it getting disturbed by all sorts of extraneous.
So, choosing a large switch resistance and a small capacitance, while it seems okay from the point of view of time constant, one thing that I would think about is to say, hey, our information, right, the all crucial input signal is being stored on a capacitor as charge. Now, if I have a very small capacitance, it means that the amount of charge on that capacitance is also small, which means that one way or the other, it is going to be easily susceptible to extraneous disturbances. One such thing is noise. Okay. So, now we will take a closer look at what happens during the sampling phase. So, let us say there is a constant input voltage V in. During the track phase, there is a resistor which models the switch. Unfortunately, every resistor, as you know, is also associated with a noise source. All right, all of you are aware of this? Thermal noise, correct? So, we model this noise source as a voltage in series with the resistor, and here is the capacitor. All right. Now, nothing is lost if I move this noise source out here. So, this is the model for a resistor in thermal equilibrium with its surroundings. The spectral density of Vn, in other words, Vn is a noise source with 0 mean and has a spectral density (4 kT)/R(ON). What are the units? Volt square per hertz. Okay. K is the Boltzmann's constant. T is the absolute temperature in Kelvin, and R is the value of the resistor. What does this physically mean? What does it mean when we say the spectral density or the noise spectral density of the resistor is 4 kT/R volt square per hertz?
It should be very less.
What does it mean? Pardon? No, that's okay. That's not what I'm looking for. What does it? I mean, what does the statement mean? The spectral density of the noise voltage in series with the resistor is 4 kT R on volt square per hertz. It is constant obviously with as a function of frequency. I mean that is not, you are restating the formula in words, right, that is not what I am looking for. What does it mean physically? I mean if you say, you know, XYZ weighs 40 kilograms, what does it mean physically? You take him, put him on a balance and then it will read 40, you know, on a weighing machine it will read 40 kilos, that is what it means, right. So by the same token, if I say the spectral density of this noise source is 4 kT R on, what does this mean?
The energy associated with the noise is 4 kT R.
What is the meaning of, I mean first of all this has got dimensions of volt square per hertz, correct?
When you pass this voltage source through a band pass filter with a 1 hertz bandwidth, the output spectral density will be, I mean the mean square value of that voltage will be 4 kT R on.
Yes, okay. So what this means is that if I took this resistor which when in thermal equilibrium with its surroundings has a noise source in series with it, if I monitor this voltage will simply be Vn of t, correct? If I just put, if I record the voltage across those two terminals, it will be some Vn of t, okay. Now if I took this waveform, pass this through a band pass filter centered at some frequency f naught, but has a bandwidth of 1 hertz. What do you think will happen to the output of the band pass filter? What will you see? Will you see anything or will you not see anything at all? I mean clearly you are taking a filter and driving it with some noisy waveform, so at the output of the filter you will see something. The frequency of that something will be, the frequency content will be that around f naught, but with the bandwidth of only 1 hertz, because I have put a band pass filter, ideal band pass filter with a bandwidth of 1 hertz. Now this is some waveform here, correct? I can always find its mean square value, okay. So the mean square value happens to be 4 kT times R on, what will be the dimensions? The input is a voltage, band pass filter, the output is also voltage, the mean square must have dimensions of volt square, okay. So we will continue with this after the break.